ज्ञानम परमम ध्येयम, नॉलेज इज सुप्रीम।
Now we move on to the next part of our discussion of vibrational spectroscopy. So far we had worked with the assumption that the potential is half kx square, the bond behaves like a harmonic oscillator. But as you understand, especially for diatomic molecules, the bond cannot behave like a harmonic oscillator, because if that is the case, then even when x is infinity, the bond will not break, isn't it? It's a parabola, it just keeps going up. But then, as you know, HCl does break. If you make it vibrate too much, then it's going to break. So it is impossible that in a real molecule, in a real diatomic molecule at least, you can have these harmonic potentials. As we'll see later on, in case of polyatomic molecules, you can have what are called normal modes of vibration, which are actually harmonic. Okay, but for diatomic molecules at least, this cannot be the right potential. So we have studied so far. So the correct potential for a diatomic molecule has to be something like this. For large values of x, it has to turn and reach a saturation. Okay, this kind of an oscillator is called an anharmonic oscillator. The potential that is used most commonly to describe an anharmonic oscillator is called Morse potential. You do not have to remember it, but you can think in which ways we can try to arrive at this potential. In the discussion we had about rho vibrational spectra, if you remember the last expression we had for the energy of the spectral lines, what was the correction term? The correction term was B1 minus B0 multiplied by J plus 1 whole square, right? So if you now look at the entire expression, what is it? You have a term which is 0th order in J plus 1. Then you have a term that is first order, right? And then you have a term that is second order. Similarly, what you can do is you can expand this potential. You have half kx square, right? That is the potential energy for a harmonic oscillator. Now you can take something which is x to the power 4, and this way you can try and get the correct potential. That is actually an ongoing problem. People even now try to use different kinds of potentials to see where they get the best result. But the globally accepted potential that we use at least at this level is Morse potential, which gives you a nice curve like this. And then if you look at this region, you see the deviation from harmonicity is not much. Anharmonicity causes a small deviation from harmonicity. And when that happens, as you all know by now, we can use what is called perturbation theory. When the deviation from the ideal situation is not too much, then we can get away using perturbation theory. That is what is done. Anharmonicity is dealt with as a small perturbation, and that is how the problem is solved. And when it is solved, this is the result. We are not going to solve the actual quantum mechanics of an harmonic oscillator, but the results look like this. What is the major difference from harmonic oscillator? In harmonic oscillator, we had energy levels that were equispace, right? Now we have energy levels that keep coming closer and closer and closer as you go higher up the ladder. Why does that happen? That happens because of anharmonicity. Because eventually there cannot be any energy level beyond this, isn't it? This is where all the energy levels should come together, and that is where you should reach what is called the classical limit. And this energy difference is called the dissociation energy. Okay? So what is the expression for the energy? If you remember perturbation theory, you know in perturbation theory we write the Hamiltonian as the 0th order Hamiltonian plus first order correction to Hamiltonian. Energy once again is the uncorrected energy first plus the first order correction term. Here also the first order correction that comes, and I think you can now guess what the first order correction term would be if you remember our experience with low vibrational spectrum. This uncorrected energy is in V plus half. The first order correction term comes as a second order term in V plus half, okay, minus V plus half. Why minus? Because as you can see, the energies actually go down as you go higher up the ladder, and this is multiplied by Xc multiplied by nu bar. What is Xc? It is called the anharmonicity constant. Now, what should it be related to? What should it be related to? What is the major difference between a harmonic oscillator and anharmonic oscillator? Exactly. A simple harmonic oscillator can oscillate without breaking, and anharmonic oscillator. So the main difference between harmonic and anharmonic oscillator is dissociation energy. Okay. So you understand that this Xc has to be related to dissociation energy. What is the dissociation energy for a harmonic oscillator? Infinite. What should Xc be for a harmonic oscillator? Zero, right? You are right, right? And when you have some value of d, Xc also shows up. So of course you understand that it is inversely proportional. The actual relationship is something like this: Xc is nu bar divided by 4dE. So if you can determine Xc, the anharmonicity constant, you can now find out what the dissociation energy is. All right? Yeah. What shows up after solving? Yeah, yes. It comes from a perturbation theoretical treatment of the anharmonic oscillator problem. It's not curve fitting. Now, for this, the selection rule looks amusing. The selection rules, as you can see in front of you, are delta V equal to plus minus 1, plus minus 2, plus minus 3. And that should actually make you wonder why we call them selection rule. Because plus minus 2, plus minus 2, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, plus minus 3, so on and so forth, essentially means all transitions are possible. So where is the selection? You understand what I am saying? Where is the selection? Why do we call it selection rule? We call it selection rule because this delta V equal to plus minus 1 is by far the most probable transition. Delta V equal to plus minus 2 has significantly lower probability. Delta V equal to plus minus 3 has significantly lower probability than even delta V equal to plus minus 2, and we will show you the evidence for that. Okay? So what we are trying to say is, delta V equal to plus minus 1, plus minus 2, plus minus 3, fine. But this is the order in which decrease in probability also takes place, probability of transition. Question? How do you determine probability of transition? Well, again, we will take a range check on that question. Just believe me now when I say probability of transition is proportional to the square of transition moment integral. Okay? We are going to prove that maybe in couple of weeks. Probability of transition is proportional to this square of the transition moment integral. Okay. Now, why is it that all transitions are allowed? Because what is transition moment integral? You remember? Integral psi f divided psi f mu psi I. We are working under the ambit of perturbation theory. We have already discussed how you describe the Hamiltonian, how you describe the energy. how do you describe wave function of a perturbed system in terms of the wave function of the unperturbed system? Again, it will be psi 0 plus some first order correction. Now, I do not know if you have studied this, but more often than not, what you want to do is you want to represent this first order correction as a linear combination of the unperturbed wave functions. Do you know this? You know this, right? Why do we do it? And we could have done anything, right? Why do we do it? And is this treatment valid? Can somebody answer that question? Is it valid to write the perturbed wave function as a linear combination of unperturbed wave functions? Why is it valid? Because we have a complete set of wave functions for the harmonic oscillator. So, anything, so when you have a complete set, what you can do is the coefficients are in your hand, right? So, you can change the coefficients in such a way that again somebody talked about curve fitting. Now it boils down to curve fitting. You have a set of functions, some polynomials, let us say. I can always combine them in many different ways to reach what I want to fit. Okay. So, of course, if I write it like this, let us say I want to talk about the vth level of the perturbed system. Okay. Actually, what I should write it as is the unperturbed wave function plus some correction term, right? So, this correction term is the linear combination, but then I might as well include this in the linear combination, is not it? This is one particular V, these are many different Vs, Vi. So, I might as well include everything and write something like this, sum over I, Ai, psi, I just write psi I 0. Can you comment on what these Ai's will look like? If I plot say Ai versus I and I am trying to reach some particular psi V, I am trying to get the expression of some particular psi V perturbed system. Let us say that psi V is somewhere here, this is the V. What can I draw a plot that will kind of tell me at least qualitatively what the distribution of the amplitudes are? Just look at this expression, psi V is this, and do not forget where we started from. We started from psi V 0 plus psi V dash. Do not forget psi V dash is a small term with respect to psi V 0. Yes. So, it will be something like this. Is that right? Have you understood, Sushnato? Sure. The coefficient of psi V 0 is going to be maximum, of course. That has largely it is actually the unperturbed wave function, and then it will fall off on the two sides. So, psi V equal to 1 and psi V equal to minus 1, the unperturbed wave functions, they will have a significant contribution, right? Psi V plus 1 and psi V plus 2 and psi V minus 2 will a little less, and so on and so forth, right? So, when you expand this transition moment integral, then you essentially get something like that. The probability also falls off on the two sides. So, V to V plus 1, V to V plus 2, everything is allowed, but the probability falls off as you move further and further away from V. Understood? Okay. I will share a couple of pages from Grabiel's book where this is discussed with a particular example. But do not forget that example is an arbitrary, I am not done. Alright, let us finish this discussion. This is what it is. So, I think you already know the remaining part, but we will just go through it for the sake of completeness. For delta V equal to plus minus 1, that is called the fundamental transition, plus minus 2 is the first overtone, and plus minus 3 is a second overtone. Plus minus 3 is a second overtone. Where have you encountered these terms earlier? Fundamentals and overtones. Sound waves, right? And physics chapter of sound. Now, one thing that we need to remember, and this is very simple algebra, so you could do it yourself. This is what we get. The energy gaps, the energy of the fundamental is nu bar multiplied by 1 minus 2xc. It is not just nu bar. First overtone is 2 nu bar multiplied by 1 minus 3xc. Second overtone in this case is 3 nu bar multiplied by 1 minus 4xc. So, it is not nu bar, 2 nu bar, 3 nu bar. Please remember that. So, it's this is a little childish animation, but well, this is what it looks like. Okay. So, as you go higher up, the energy is more and more smaller than what is expected. To conclude this discussion, let me show you a real spectrum, this time of carbon monoxide. This is the fundamental peak at 2143. This is the first overtone at 4260. Now, if I give you these two values, what can you figure out? What can you figure out? I don't know the names of these guys. What can you work out if I tell you that the fundamental occurs at 2163 centimeter inverse and the first overtone occurs at 4260 centimeter inverse? No. Yeah, please tell me. Louder. Repeat the question. I am telling you that the fundamental occurs at 2143 centimeter inverse. The first overtone occurs at 4260 centimeter inverse. If I give you these values, what are the molecular parameters that you can work out? So, if I go back to the energy expression, you can figure out what is nu bar, and that tells you how strong the bond is. You can also figure out what is xc, right? Two variables, two unknowns, the two variables and two equations. So, you can determine both, and from xc you can say what is the dissociation energy. Last question, why do these look like this? Why don't I have one line in fundamental? So, I hope you have noted how small the first overtone is compared to the fundamental. Now, my question is, why do I have such a funny structure? Why do I not have one line here and one line there? Because who has said that rho vibrational spectrum will not be observed if it is anharmonic oscillator? Of course, it will be observed. So, whatever algebra we did in the discussion of rho vibrational spectrum holds here as well. Okay? And in fact, if you have a good enough spectrum, what I am showing you here is a low resolution IR spectrum. If I actually show you a high resolution IR spectrum, this is what it looks like. This here is the fundamental, that is the first overtone. You see clear PR structure, and do you see there is another PR branch here? Smaller PR branch there. Why? Again, isotope effect, right? Isotope of what? Carbon or oxygen? Carbon. C13 is there in a small amount, right? That's why you can do C13 NMR and all. So, that is what shows up in this spectrum as well. So, see, nu has changed, nu has itself changed, and also spacing has changed. Okay? That completes our discussion of IR spectroscopy. But we still have one more question to ask, which is very important in metallurgy. The question is this. Suppose we know very well how to do microwave spectroscopy and IR spectroscopy. Now, let us think of the simple non-metal H2. Is it impossible for us to determine the rotational levels, energies and vibrational energies of H2? From the discussion so far, it is impossible, right? Because H2 does not have a dipole moment, no matter how much it vibrates, it will never develop a dipole moment. So, the way out is using the perhaps most important Indian contribution to modern science, that is Raman effect. If you do Raman spectroscopy, then you can actually get an idea of rotational and vibrational levels of nonpolar molecules as well. That is what we discuss tomorrow.